the mighty Caleb Valhalla. And this is SWN. Skull! Skull! Skull!
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of SWN Podcast. It is road trip time again. We're back in the car. I've got my trusty driver here.
Hi.
We are ready for WrestleZone Aberdeen Anarchy. We're on our way. I can't wait. Can you not wait?
I can't wait to see Caleb win.
Well, we'll go through predictions in a minute.
Caleb's going to win.
Even though Kelly's going to be wrong. We're on our way. It's Dainston Community Centre. I've realised I need to make sure I put in directions for the medical practice so we actually find the venue. Although, apparently it's just along the road from the Tesco. I just got lost last time. So, there's that.
That doesn't surprise me at all.
It was dark. What can I do? It was dark. So, we're on our way. We're on the road. Not a train. That joke's played out now, but we're still in the car. I can't wait. This is my favourite event of the year. I mean, the Rumble is like right underneath it when you go Rumble, because you get a Rumble.
But Rumble's definitely my favourite.
Aberdeen Anarchy is like your culmination of the year. It's your WrestleMania. It's if someone you like just won the Rumble, it makes it even more exciting. Mm-hmm. And for my in our case, the main event is split this family apart.
A little bit.
With my old son wearing a Caleb Valhalla vest this morning.
You were wearing a Caleb Valhalla t-shirt yourself.
I am not now, though. Just to confirm, I am not. I wear an Aspen Faith t-shirt because I, of course, will be supporting Aspen in the main event. I'll be crying probably. I've already cried this week at Guardians of the Galaxy. I'm going to cry at this as well.
No spoilers.
Because I'm just an emotional beast now that we've got a child.
That's what happens.
I've spent 30.
Didn't cry when I walked down the aisle. Didn't cry when your son was born, but you cried at a movie.
I've spent 30 years cultivating this stoic, robotic, non-emotional image. And in the last week and last year, I have become an absolute mess of a human. Anywho.
You're a mess of a human. What the hell am I? Moving on.
So we're going Dainston. We're stopping at Dice Farm first to get a good slap up feed.
Biscran.
Can't wait. What's it called? It's a buffet.
It's a carvery.
Carvery, that's the word. Because we went last time before we went to the Rumble, and it was amazing, and I'm going to do it again and roll my way to Dainston Community Centre. Thankfully, there's a hill before you get to the venue, so that's fine. So the show itself, let's get on to the actual show, because if people are watching these, they really want to just find out what's happening at the show, and maybe they want to know our thoughts as well. So we'll start with the pre-show.
Uh-huh.
We've got the pre-show match for it starts at 5:30, VIP meet and greet, and then take a seat, watch the show. Can't wait for the VIP meet and greet, even though I've met everyone that's going to be on the show. Maybe I'll get a picture of the outfit.
Maybe you will.
All three of them. Or two and a half of them. So we've got the pre-show. We have Oliver Green. He's the guy with the tattoo in the armpit.
Okay.
Against Ted O'Keefe, everyone's favourite farmer. this is for your VIPs. You get your bonus match. You know what? I think it's gonna be a nice little match.
A little bit over to word. I can't speak. I'm sure I'm a hobbit, so you know.
Haven't seen Ted wrestle in a while. Last time we've seen him was Summer Hill Showdown.
Was it?
Yeah, that was the tag team match for Dino and when they started breaking stuff. It was Dino and Ted against Omar and Scott.
Was I there?
Yeah, you were there. It was okay. When Aspen came back.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that's when they started breaking sandwich panels and all that kind of stuff and throwing each other in the merch stand. And then Ted disappeared, and the next show, Ellen Murphy arrived. No, re-arrived as one of the outfit. Murphy. So but I think it's going to be a nice little match. It's going to reintroduce folk to Ted, for those that want to forget him. And Oliver Green, it'll be his first singles match in front of a big crowd. I think he wrestled at the Training Academy show and got battered by Chris Archer.
Uh-huh.
So it'll be nice. He's going to have a And the last time he was actually at Dean's, he was refereeing, I think he was refereeing the main event, or he was refereeing some of the matches on that show at the Christmas Chaos. So it's quite cool that he's gone from refereeing at the venue to now wrestling at the venue as well. So that should be, should be nice and fun. So predictions?
Oliver Green.
I'm going to go Oliver Green as well.
I don't really know what I'm talking about, but I'm going to predict him anyway.
Much to the surprise of nobody listening to this. Yeah, it's going to be, I think, Oliver Green. But like I said, I think it's going to be a nice little match. So it's going to be, people are going to be nicely sports entertained. Mm-hmm. Main show. What are your favourite matches you're looking forward to? It's a six-person title opportunity ladder match.
I'm just not a fan. I'm not a fan of ladder matches. I really don't enjoy them. It's just, everybody's got a bugbear. That's mine.
So watch me try and remember who's in them. So we've got Zach Dynamite.
Uh-huh.
We've got William Sterling.
Yeah.
We've got Dino and Murphy. Murphy.
Murphy.
We've got Tommy Raiden.
Uh-huh.
And Connor Malloy.
Okay.
Sorry, Connor, I almost forgot you there. I always forget one person when I'm doing the list in my head.
Yeah.
but yeah, so Connor, I don't know what's gonna happen. It's one of the ones where it's quite, you don't know who's gonna win.
Like, sorry, it's Zach Dynamite and who?
So Zach Dynamite, oh god. Zach Dynamite, William Sterling, Dino.
So they're tagging?
No.
No. Oh, it's just six men.
It's just six men. Right. Sorry. Just six individuals.
Completely out of the loop.
It's because Dino and Murphy are in there, that's what's causing
the confusion. And it's
because
they're
attacking,
yeah.
So it's Dynamite, Sterling, Dino, Murphy, Connor, and Tormented.
Dynamite.
See, I was speaking to Aspen. And Caleb, you know, had a podcast with him.
We're
kind of discussing the Zach doesn't. There's obviously the motivation to go for them to be a title again, but he's already the Tri-County champion. So, is he wanting to get himself in a position where he's going to be injured in the match, so whoever wins can just cash in on straight away? Because it's just a title opportunity. There's no. It doesn't say if you win it, you get a title match in Battle of Nations. So there's all chance that someone could win it and go, oh, Dynamite's battered. I'm just going to cash him in the title shot now. It just batters Zach Dynamite.
Yeah.
You know? So we're saying
that would make for a good show.
It would be interesting. So, I do have a theory about that cash in, though, which I'll tell you now, because they're not going to see it. Because they're not going to see it. So if I do get it right, I will look really, really pretty smug about it. So down in Glasgow way.
Yeah.
Connor and Ronan King recently were a tag team called Aberdeen Dream Team.
Oh, that sounds amazing.
Hey, it looked amazing. You should see the pictures where Kyle and Kayla were front row. And Connor, of course, spotted them and did a bit of grinding on them.
Wait.
So, if in my head here, uh-huh. I'm thinking if this match is first, Connor's going to win. Right? And then we'll get onto Ronan versus Damien in a bit, but I think Connor's going to help Ronan beat Damien.
And they're going to become
a tag team. And then we can either get them against a newly embraced, because I think after the tag team match, we're just going to go over the place now. After the tag team match, for Foundation of Future, Fair City Saints, I think it's going to be like really even, there's going to be a bit of respect, everyone's going to clap hands at the end, and everyone's going to be nice, you know, and people are going to embrace Brad and Ryan as cheer them. So I think we can either get Foundation of the Future against Ronan and Connor, which will be amazing, or we'll get the Saints versus Connor and Ronan, which will be amazing.
Okay, so either way, everybody wins.
Exactly. So in my theory here, Connor's winning for that reason. What's your bet? Well, Tommy Raiden, we haven't mentioned Tommy Raiden really. He's first Aberdeen Anarchy. He only debuted. When did we go to Trade Centre? October?
I think so.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
It wasn't long after Jack. Well, it was my first kind of
dipping my toe back into the wrestling
after Jack was born.
Yeah, so I'd say October. I think it was a couple of weeks before Halloween hijinks. So yeah, October.
I didn't come to Halloween hijinks, but you went dressed as Mickey
Vago. There's Mickey Vago. I tell you that someone, I think it was Martin, or someone went up to Vago before his match and went, oh, someone's come dressed as you, and he thought it was a child.
Oh,
And then when he came down ringside, he was like, ah, for fuck's sake.
I don't blame him. Your costume was horrendous, but it was amazing at the same time.
You knew where I was because your old leather jacket was flaking that much. It just had left a trail behind me.
My old pleather jacket, thank you very much.
Pleather jacket, my apologies. So, where are we?
It's been thrown on that many dance floors. I'm surprised it didn't combust.
Oh, it's a bit, it went in the bin straight away after the interval. So a ladder match. Yes, I think Connor. Tommy been getting his first shot in Aberdeen Anarchy match on the main show, so he hasn't even went to the pre-show.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good win in itself.
Yeah, what an achievement, because he's gone from just being one of the trainees in the pre-show, like. Yeah.
He's done pre-shows, he's been in the ring with Brad and Dino and Murphy and all these big lads.
Yeah.
And I was in a six-man ladder match.
Just one of them, so
that could be a good, a big moment for him as well as everyone else. So like I say, Connor, that's my pick.
Okay.
Your pick? You said Zach, didn't you?
I said Zach.
So moving on, let's go for Roland. Damien next then, because I've already put my theory on what's happening. So I think it's Ronan that's going to win.
You're right, then that would be awesome. Mm-hmm. I think they would make a really good tag team, so I would quite like to manifest that too.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean I want Damien to lose.
Especially with the story of it build up of disrespect, and then of course Regal Rumble, Ronan.
So maybe I think Damien will win the match. But then Connor will come in and give him a smack, and then they'll become then they'll become the tag team.
Yeah.
But I don't know. That's just my thoughts.
Yeah, you get your little bit
you
of feel good.
You get a bit more of a show then that way, don't you? You know, there's the shock factor.
You get a little bit of the feel good of Damien winning.
Experience, you know, the whole. I hate to use this word, but the whole pantomime of wrestling.
Oh yeah. Oh, wrestling's banto. It's the best kind of banto.
Absolutely. But, you know, I think that's maybe what will happen, how it will work.
Yeah, I think because at Regal Rumble, Ronan, started picking on his daughter, Damien's daughter, I think that'll come back to bite him in the match. Mm-hmm. But whether that'll just, lead to a big emotional nearfall, and then Connor will come in and help. I don't know, it's going to be... It's one of those ones, a lot of these matches, you're going to be going, oh, this could happen, and then none of it will happen. But you can sit there and think of all the ways that it could happen. You've kind of swayed me there, because I was going for Ronan, but you kind of swayed me there thinking Damien might win, and then something will happen.
If you remember correctly, I predicted the Rumble.
Final two, which was within an inch. Final two, very impressive.
For someone who doesn't really know what they're talking about,
you go with your emotions in your heart.
I do. I've got nothing else to go for.
I'm still going to pick Ronan because he won last year, and if he remains undefeated at Aberdeen Anarchy, I think that just feeds his ego a bit more.
Okay.
I like Ronan. Even though he's absolutely deplorable in what he does, and I'm happy to boo him at shows, he's very good.
He's very good, yeah. Still haven't forgiven him for slagging off my child.
So that's why you support Damon then, because for all the parents out there.
Mm-hmm. You slagged off my child first, Damien. You have to beat him up for me!
So speaking of mystery then, look at the segues.
Ooh.
What would think of a podcaster? We've got Captain Alan Sterling.
Toot toot!
He was meant to face Deacon Matthews.
Yeah.
Deacon Matthews has broke a rib.
At the Rumble, Alan wasn't there for whatever reason, so Deacon Matthews didn't fight him then.
No, you're thinking of Archer.
Oh, okay. I'm right now. Edit that bit out there.
I will not.
So I don't look stupid.
So Deacon is injured, so he's sending a replacement.
Okay.
So that's where we're going with that.
But we don't know who that's going to be.
We don't know who it is.
Okay.
And there's been no clues.
Right.
And I was listening to Vago's podcast, and pretty much he not so subtly said, "My idea was stupid." So I don't think it's my fault.
What was your idea?
My thought, there's a guy down in wrestles in Reckless Intent, and they've just closed their door, they've went on a hiatus recently, called Rob Mills. And his character is, he's a pirate.
So we'd have a sailor and a pirate.
We'd have a sailor versus a pirate.
Okay.
And it makes all the sense in the world to me, other than nobody in WrestleZone, the general fans there will know who he is. That is my general fans. That is the only drawback in my prediction is nobody might know.
Nobody'll get it.
Yeah, nobody will know who Rob Mills is.
Okay.
So that leaves us with I don't know who's it gonna be. We haven't seen Mr. P and Sean Johnson for a while.
We haven't. I missed them.
Last time they wrestled was Christmas Chaos at Dates the Community Centre. Interestingly enough.
Was it?
You have. They weren't the Rumble. That was the last one you went to. But the Christmas Chaos when Aspen won the title, that was the last show they wrestled on. They took off like their gloves and hung them on the ropes and then left. Okay. It was very weird. Sean jumped on my lap to get a picture, which again was very out of character for him. So it was just there was a weird atmosphere about it. So that was the last time we wrestled. So it could be them. I don't know. It could be a Sisto. I know Adam would love that. He hates the sisters. I don't know why. Maybe he just doesn't like that mask. Can't see the face. Like clowns. Could be Lord Mr. Malice. Back from the dead.
Again.
There's always break glass in case of emergency. Blue Thunder on commentary.
Yeah.
Johnny Lyons.
That would be cool.
It would be cool. I still don't know if it would be like diminishing returns because he made his big return last year. For one off, and then would it be a surprise if he came back again? You know who I'd like?
Who?
Evan Young.
Yeah, we've not seen him for a really long time.
I haven't seen Evan Young in ages. That would be nice to see Evan back. So if it's not going to be Rob Mills, I'd quite like it to be Evan.
Yeah.
So as a prediction goes, though, we don't know who Alan's against, so kind of.
Then in that case, we'll have to go with Alan. I would love it if it was Jack Jester, but that ain't going to happen.
Jack Jester's wrestling at the pavilion today.
That's why it ain't gonna happen.
Yeah, he's at the pavilion at Grado's family bash.
Oh, okay.
So that's probably against Grado. That seems to be what the match happens in the pavilion. Because, you know, the biggest
face. We're not talking about that.
Anyway, we're not. We are. Right, where are we now then? So we'll leave the main event last. So we'll go for the tag team match. We'll go 2 out of 3 falls because we kind of already mentioned it.
2 out of 3 falls.
We've got the Foundation of the Future, Bruiser Brad, and Ryan Riley. God, I almost forgot his name in that. This is just a thing we do in this episode.
It's just a thing.
Against the tag team champions, Fair City Saints, in a 2 out of 3 falls match.
Okay.
So
Fair City Saints.
Okay. Fair City Saints have beaten them twice on the bounce at Christmas Chaos and at Regal Rumble. They're the tag team champions.
Tonight's going to be a hat trick.
I don't know. And I think if ladder match is first, which I would think it probably will be, because they'll do the pre-show and then they can set up the title above the ring and then it'll be the first match. I think if like Dino or Murphy win the ladder match, it might be the Saints. Murphy. I think it'll be the Saints. But then again, I've already given you my theory on Connor and Ronan, so it could be either team at that point. But yeah, I don't know. I mean,
to be honest with you, I don't have a preference either way on this one because I like both sides.
Yeah.
So I don't really mind who wins, but I hope that if it comes down to it, it's Webb and Riley on the last fall.
It's tag team match all falls. But you mean like when it's the last final showdown, it's Riley and Webb? Okay.
Yeah. I don't know what I'm talking about.
That's
I don't know the technicalities or the fancy words to use, but I want it to be
the final bit.
The last fall, that's what I said.
Okay. I'm just getting your meaning.
I'll explain it.
So I mean it should be good because the match at the Regal Rumble was ace. Especially with Air Miles like turning inside out from Ryan. Was it Ryan? I think it was Ryan. Was it a big clothesline at the start? Miles just like flipped. was amazing. So it's, it could be a good match. These guys, these two teams are just really, really good. And probably the best in the country when it comes to tag team wrestling. There's a lot of teams that can probably throw their name in the hat there, but I would say these two teams are probably the best of the bunch. And seem to be getting a boot new, so that's always good. So that was nice and quick, because we kind of already spoke a little bit about it.
Yeah.
I haven't picked, because again, I'm the same as you, I don't know. I would be happy either way. And I think, like I said, I think it's going to end with, like, a nice, the match goes as well as other matches have gone, I'll end with a nice stand ovation, all four in the ring, shaking hands, foundation are good guys.
Yeah.
So, we'll go with that. Mosh pit. We'll go mosh pit then. Mickey Vago against Chris Archer in a mosh pit rules match.
Oh my god.
We have already found out that one of the weapons that Mickey Vago has already explained that why it's legal is a beer keg. Because Slipknot plays a keg. I think Slipknot. They play one of their instruments is a beer keg. So we know that's going to be in the match. So all
that's
instruments,
brutal.
All instruments are legal. So we know that's going to be there. They have not taken on board Aspen's suggestion, one of which was guitar, Cat and Nine Tails, made from guitar strings. That didn't make it.
As somebody that's been re-watching Outlander, that's just gave me the bulk.
So that didn't make the cut, apparently.
Good. Because that could be lethal.
Apparently, Vago was also looking for, like, just cheap records, vinyl records, to use, but because vinyl's in at the moment, it was very difficult to find.
There's no cheap ones.
So that's possibly out as well. So I'm assuming it'll be things like drums, guitars. I wonder how much, like, powder is going to put into the guitar, because last year's...
I just want to see somebody go through a drum now.
last year's...
I don't care who it is. I just want to see somebody go through a big bass drum.
But, like, so last year's Anarchy, they had a guitar.
I don't
know. The Ronin ended up using, and there was so much powder in it, once it hit the... pretty much the whole Northern Hotel hall just filled with powder. To the point where they broke at least one broom trying to sweep the ring. It was hilarious. It was also the one that was afterwards. Ronin hit Mickey with the guitar, threw it backwards, and hit someone in the front row. So if as long as nobody in the front row gets hurt, I think that's a success. So, predictions then. Archer or Vago?
I think Archer needs a little bit of a win here, because Vago's just kind of gone and left him behind. And I think, to be honest with you, for that, Vago deserves his arse kicked.
Oh!
But, I love Vago. So, I mean, I'm pretty much sitting on the fence for all of these matches, apart from the main event, which we will get to. But I just, I don't know. I think Archer needs the win.
I agree on a logical standpoint. If they had their match at Regal Rumble, I would have went for Vago in Anarchy. But they didn't. So I think this will be the start of their kind of... I think they'll have this match, Archer will win, sneakily.
And then
they'll do something at Battle of Nations or something.
Yeah, I think Archer needs the win.
Right, okay. Yeah, I'm going to go for Archer as well. Sorry, Vago.
I mean, I think it's just, I think, that's what I mean.
I think in the course of it.
Vago kind of needs his arse kicked, because he has just left Archer behind, so... Archer deserves to just be a lolly.
I'm just glad that Vago's not going to see this, because if it's anything like the tables match from way back when, if he saw us predicting that he's going to win, he's going to lose, and he wins, he's going to just find us and just put one middle finger in each face, just going, nah.
Well then.
So.
If that happens, it happens. So, another show, obviously.
So what's that leaving? Tag team match next, Omar and Mr. WrestleZone against Rhys Dawkins and Wally Tucker.
Who is Mr. WrestleZone?
Who is Mr. WrestleZone?
The mystery continues.
The mystery. We know it's not Scotty Swift. He was dog sitting, so it's definitely not Scotty Swift.
Right,
okay. A video came out around about the start of Regal Rumble of Scott being disappointed. Why am I calling him Scott? That still feels weird. He's civilian Scott now. Scotty Swift, he was dog sitting, so he definitely wasn't there. Definitely not Scotty Swift. Don't know who it is. Maybe it's someone else.
Oh, maybe. So who are they
fighting? Rhys Dawkins and Wally Tucker.
Well, in that case, Omar all the way. Omar and Mr. WrestleZone.
Yep, I think this is going to be a bit of shenanigans.
Yeah.
A bit
of
fun.
This is going to be, it's going to be the funny faffing about. We're running around the ring away from each other.
Yeah.
Match.
A little bit of chicken fighting and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, because, you know, Tucker's a big Wally. I'm just going to stop there.
So, yeah, I agree it's going to be Mr. WrestleZone and Omar. Mainly because Tucker, even though they are idiots, like buffoons, uh-huh. they're always getting one up on Omar.
Yeah.
Like, constantly. They got rid of Scotty at Christmas Chaos.
A bit like the whole Chris
and
Archer Fable thing. Omar needs the win.
Yeah.
You know, so I think, I would like Omar to win that match. Mainly because I love Omar.
And the big question is will Mr. WrestleZone be wearing both his capes to the ring again? Or will he have a custom-made Shirvani?
Oh, that would be cool.
Like Shirvani, it's like got the design of a Shirvani, but a cape.
But a cape.
Oh. Oh, we've set ourselves up for disappointment now.
Probably.
So yeah, Omar is to WrestleZone all the way. I was about to say 2-2, but that's Alan. That leaves us the main event for my reckoning here. Yeah. And it'll be very embarrassing when I go through the match card and go, oh, we have not talked about that one.
Okay.
It is undisputed WrestleZone champion, the greatest wrestler in the world, Aspen Faith.
In the world? That's critical.
I need to cling on to all I've got. In the world, Aspen Faith against my second favourite wrestler in the world, Regal Rumble winner, Kelly's favourite wrestler, Caleb Valhalla. I don't know. I know who I want to win, and my brain is agreeing with it, and it's Aspen. But I would not be sad if Caleb won.
I think both guys deserve to win.
Yes.
And
you're right.
And I like both wrestlers, but like you, my heart of hearts wants it to be Caleb, and your heart of hearts wants it to be Aspen. So let's just let the cards fall where they fall. Let's not make predictions because we're going to get into an argument, and I'm driving at 60 miles an hour right now. So let's just let the cards fall where they fall.
This is good.
I support Caleb. You support Aspen, and whoever wins, wins.
So after the montage, you will find out who wins very quickly, because the other one will be in the other's face going, that's it.
Is this what other families who like football are like?
This is bigger than the old farm.
This is bigger than us now.
This is bigger. This is Aspen Caleb. It's a match. It's the most intriguing one when it comes to a main event for Aberdeen Anarchy, because it's always a clear cut bad guy, good guy.
Yeah.
Always. And this year it's both good guys, which I think Aspen finds amusing because he has not changed a single thing about his character. Just folk like him now.
Yeah.
And he's still nonplussed about everyone and everything. He's still cool.
Yeah.
And folk are like, we like Aspen now. And he's like, oh, okay. I'm still gonna bother folk.
I don't like as cool with the pigtails as he does. I don't get it. It's not fair.
You look cool wearing pigtails.
I do not.
You do.
Don't talk shite. Don't talk shite.
So that's our preview done. Of course.
Caleb's gonna win though.
It's gonna be emotional. It's gonna be emotional. All these matches all have, like, there's no clear cut winner. There's everything is up for grabs.
to be honest with you, it's probably one of the most unpredictable events that we've gone to.
Absolutely,
as
yeah.
As a couple. You know?
Yeah, because even last year's Anarchy was, like, not predictable, but...
I wouldn't know. I was too busy growing a baby.
Yeah, but for going, when you saw the card, you could kind of quite confidently say, oh, I think they're going to win.
Yeah.
But this year, none of the matches, even from the pre-show,
not cut and dry.
None of them are cut and dry, which, it always makes for a fun event.
Makes for an interesting show.
Yeah. But it's been half an hour, I think we should probably.
Okay.
We're going to Inverurie, we're almost at Dice Farm, so we'll find out, there'll be a montage, and we'll find out. You'll find out in about, I don't know how long the montage will be, 3 minutes. Find out who's won. And whoa! We'll find out. Once we make it there. You'll find out in about 3 minutes who's won the main event before we even speak about it. And I'll do a big emotional cry. And then I'll do a proper review after, like Monday or something. So, if you're going to the show, I hope you're going to enjoy it. Say goodbye, Kelly.
Goodbye, Kelly.
Right.
Say goodbye, Billy.
Goodbye, Billy. There was once a day that I would pray for you. I'd go and misbehave just so you'd notice too. Sneaking looks up and down from across the room. Damn, what a hell of a view. I feel good, you look great. I like you, I can't wait. A first time, a first date. You're so fine, I'm so late. You sip wine, I drink straight. Don't waste time to my place. I feel my heart erase. So catch me if I fall.
Breakdown everything on Monday for either the WrestleZone podcast or the road trip, but we are driving, so I don't want to keep this light because it's illegal. Our parents always told us it's illegal to put this light on.
Yeah.
But match of the night for you?
I don't want to see it because
it wasn't a test match, was it?
No.
It was the ladder match, wasn't it?
It was the ladder match.
Oh. And with that bombshell, let's, I don't know, montage, or you'll see me in the studio and I will hopefully sound better than this. So
camera tricks are coming up.
Yeah. Say goodbye, Kelly.
Goodbye, Kelly. Say goodbye, Billy.
Goodbye, Billy.
And we're back in the studio after an amazing night for Aberdeen Anarchy. I'm recording this not long after I've done the actual WrestleZone podcast, so I've said quite a lot of like what happened, the results, so I kind of go through my thoughts and feelings on this bit, which is nice, I suppose. But lots of it is, because my brain works slowly. Anyway, it was a great night. That's the overarching tale here that we've got going on. Getting there was great, because I actually remembered the directions this time, because I got lost last time, as I said in the first half. And he was great. People were great. Hang out with Kyle and Kaylee, of course, who come up to these shows. Got to see guys like Kwaku, who come up for his first. So ESSR, one of the ESR hosts. For Eat Sleep Specs tweet, I should say, because ESSR could be anything. Kwaku, also ring announcer extraordinaire. He was up for his first ever WrestleZone show. So there's a little bit of pressure, because I've been banging on about WrestleZone for 10 years now. And so, and someone comes up to these shows after all that, thinking, oh God, have I overplayed my hand here? Have I bigged this up too much? But it sounds like he had a great time, which is all I hope for in that. We've also got to see other people, David, of course, and Jonathan, and just everyone that you usually see at WrestleZone shows. It's and Hannah. I haven't seen Hannah and Rumble, but I hadn't seen her in a while beforehand. So it's just a really great night. I love going to the wrestling with Kelly as well, because I think I may have said it in previous episodes that I've been going to Scottish wrestling shows for over 10 years. So, and I've been watching wrestling since I was less than 10 years old. So I'm 32 now. So I could be a little bit, I don't know, jaded, or I've seen a lot of things when it comes to wrestling. So I like what I like, and sometimes I don't like what I don't like, and I'm quite hard pressed to get that moved around in my brain, because I've been I like this thing for so long, or I dislike this thing for so long. So see her coming to the shows, she doesn't watch them on telly or anything, any interest in that. She'll come to the live experience, and to see her reaction to stuff is amazing. It's just the best thing, because I get to see it. I get to kind of see it through her eyes, in the respect of if she's like reacting to something amazing, then I know it's amazing, kind of thing. Even though I may think it's amazing or what have you, it's just a really cool experience. I didn't get to show it on the WrestleZone podcast because the background kind of disappeared me, but I got my Granite Road t-shirt. Hang on. There we go. Skull. I got a load of merch. So much merch I could have got, because Ronan had a t-shirt which had his head replacing everyone on the Aberdeen Anarchy poster, and it was weird. It seemed so rushed, but it kind of added to Ronan King's allure of him just being, they'll buy it, it's got my face on it, kind of thing. I still think I'm due a signed photo, so Ronan, come on. I mean, I know you Damien stamped on the one you took to the ring, and then you almost stabbed his eye, but yeah, you could feel like I'm due one at this point. Just a signed photo. It doesn't need to be anything fancy. So, well, now we're getting mishmashed and all my thoughts here. Let's kind of go back to the start then. So, about the show, all cool, loved it. Picked up t-shirts, got to see referee extraordinaire Dennis, who's I think he had a good night. There was no arguable calls. There's no calls I would question his refereeing and officiating for. So Dennis is safe for another show. So got all that done. It was kind of a really cool atmosphere, party feel, because after each match or after each extended break, because the ring broke at some point. I think after the third match the ring broke. So there was an extended break. I think the ladder match was supposed to be the first half main, but they had to kind of shuffle it around a little bit, and that kind of delayed the show a little bit. So we had well, during that, it was like everyone got up from their seats, they all had a wee chat, we decompress, we comments on the show and all that kind of stuff. And it was just a nice experience to go to I mean, it's always a nice experience to go to these shows, but it was just a nice like camaraderie to see these shows. Like I said, I could check in and seeing how first timers like Baku, like Ryan as well, going to these shows, I could find out what their kind of thoughts were. And also in the crowd behind us was Retro Randy Valentine as well. So I got to see Randy for the first time in a long time, in face to face. So it was just a cool, just yeah, cool time. We've got a couple of photos that you just saw if you're watching the video version. That was kind of the VIP meet and greet. Mickey Vago was also skulking around, but I think I've had like 4 pictures with him now. I think he might be fed up again, pictures of me. I don't think I need another picture with him. But if he was in that group shot, it would have been cool. And he came in with his thumb was all wrapped up and bandaged up because he injured it like a night or two before the match, making his weapons for the mosh pit. So there was that. Where am I? Back to the start of the show. So yeah, VIP match was, I said in the first bit that it was going to be a nice little match, Oliver Green and Ted O'Keefe. It was really good. And you know what? I've said a lot of things about Ted. He has a lot of opinions on me. I just like playing about up to it. I don't have any ill will towards him, like to Ted O'Keefe. But yeah, it was irritatingly good. It was just a really good match, and I'm sitting there going, "Oh, it was good. Damn it!" I really kind of wanted to go, "Oliver, he was amazing. Ted was okay." But no, it was a really good match. It was a good VIP match. Ted looks to maybe embrace his role in front of a crowd a bit more now. Maybe he's not taking things as personally. I don't know. That's just, again, that's the outsider's view. I don't know. I'm not just directing it to you as the viewer, but to Ted, I don't know. I just know that he had a good match in the pre-show, and it did annoy me a little bit, but in a good way, you know? It's not like I'm annoyed because you had a bad match. I'm annoyed you had a good match. It was just, yeah. I'm digging myself a hole here. Let's just get out. So yeah, that was good. Thank you for the handshake as well. It was a very weird moment because people know that I'm not great with social interaction at all. I'm really trying hard to improve on that. And it was just a very weird moment where you came up and gave me a handshake. And I was like, I know we don't really see eye to eye in the world. In that moment, it was like, okay, cool. So that was the pre-show. Started with the mosh pit. But before that, oh, the best thing. So one of the best things was Mr. P coming back. So Mr. P, Christmas Chaos, that was his kind of, he rode off into the sunset, so to speak. Just he took his gloves off, put them on the second rope, and that was him, along with Sean Johnson. And to start the show with Mr. P, massive flag, suited, booted, and looking snazzy, handsome, you may say, came out and announced he was now the head of WrestleZone. And like I said in our recap, that was his position when I met Mr. P 10 years ago. He was doing the backstage running about during the VIP meet and greet in 2013, and I gave him my spare ticket, and I got it sold and all that kind of stuff. And it was so cool to see Mr. P, because I love Mr. P. Yes, there's just the line which I was already hyped for the show, and again I just seen the pre-show. It was a really good match. Oliver Green as well. I think he's going to do really well. He's going to do really well in WrestleZone, and it's, yeah, hope he does as well, because it was a really, really good match. It was Mr. P announcing that he was going to be the judge, jury, and executioner for WrestleZone, and oh my god, nobody else reacted to that particular line as much as me and Kelly did. Kelly went banana for that line in particular. I love Mr. P. I hope it means that he still lets the super executioner out every so often. I wouldn't mind if we get to see the super executioner, of course, because I love the super executioner. But that line was just, oh, chef's kiss. That led us into the first match. Chris Archer came out looking all mean mugging and confronted Mr. P, who then just went, ah, you know what, mosh pit rules starts now. And out came Archer and out came Vago. And this was just carnage, as it's supposed to be. Christmas, all these Christmas chaos, embracing the chaos. as it should be. That's the kind of perfect way to go, right, I'm Mr. P, it's going to be chaotic, I'm going to try and keep control of it, but I'm going to embrace some of the chaos. First match, mosh pit, there we go, in we go. And it was just carnage. I had everything. I did get a video of Vago's first attempt at the Coast to Coast. I deleted it. You may be glad to know. I haven't sent it to Matthew at Botchamania. Although if he wants me to, I will gladly do that. I can send it to Matthew. Just let me know, Vago. So with that, it was just, there was so much, like the guitar, the green mist as well. I can't remember if I mentioned that in the last video about this. Had a big board around the other side of the ring. I didn't see what was on it. I think it said mosh pit. I don't know if that was just like a used as a barrier. I know Mickey Vago is very vague and loose on rules and he has a loophole for everything. So I am not judging the legality of anything that he has in his matches, because I've learned very quickly when it comes to Mickey Vago, he has a reason for it, and that's the end of that. And if you don't agree with it, he will mock you relentlessly for it for, what is it now, 5 years? For 6 years? I don't know how many years it's been since the legality tables came into my life. So we had that. Second match was Captain Allen coming out, and I thought, geez, they're piling the big guns in at the start of the show with all the surprises and the big things. And we had Captain Allen come out, and his opponent was Evan Young. And we said it in the first half. We said it in the first half. We hoped it was Evan Young. Yes. Yes. I was kind of thinking Big O' Balance. I was thinking Johnny Lyons as well. But I thought, well, who could it be? Evan Young came out. And, you know, I said, again, I'm going to reference things I saw, said in the recap video. I've missed Evan Young. He's nice. He's just nice. And he's got a lot of upside about him. He's a really positive role model for fans as well. It was just so weird seeing him come out and he's got tattoos and all that kind of stuff. I'm like, oh no, you're still young, because you're still way younger than I am. But it was just like, oh, you've grown up in that time. And he had his break for whatever reason. That's not for me to discuss, but it's just great to see him back. And that's another good hand to have in your roster core for WrestleZone as well, to have Evan back. Captain Allen was on form. He switched up a little bit. He's the buffoon at ringside and with the crowd and that. But in the ring, he got a little bit more aggressive. Most aggressive I've seen him in quite a while. And it's kind of thrown in a little bit of Sterling Oil, Alan Sterling, in there, because he was just pissed off that Evan Young had returned. It was, of course, he wasn't ready for his opponent and all that kind of stuff. So there was a little bit of Captain Allen in there, but there was a little bit of Sterling Oil Allen as well. So it was nice little meshing of it all. Of course, Allen won by cheating. So we don't know if Captain Evan is going to get is going to have another one-on-one match, or if he's going to team with Deacon, and or whatever's going to happen. So I think at the moment there's no proper shows, maybe training academy shows, but there's no proper shows until August something, start of August for Battle of the Nations. There is a little, I've got a little leaflet somewhere about it, but I'll wait for WrestleZone to actually announce it instead, which by the time this video actually comes out, it will have been announced, I think. I think it's supposed to be announced this week as I'm recording. So we've got Battle of the Nations coming up, which I'm hoping to get to. That's my fingers crossed. What was after that? Should get the results back up in front of me. I think it was the tag team match next, because I am super organized. Super organized for the actual like WrestleZone podcast, because, you know, that's one I try to keep kind of serious. It was a tag team match, Dirty Three Falls. Again, thank you to Kelly for being the only other person with me that would chant Two Out of Three Falls. You know, it's just the things you do with these shows. Foundation of the Future defeating Fair State Saints 2-1. Again, wild, chaotic. These are the two best teams in the country. I would easily put them in my top five. So, I mean, of course, it would change daily when I go online and I see some other bits and pieces and other things other tag teams have done. They get, like, swirled in that top five pool. But for my money, Foundation, Future, Fair State Saints are there. in that top five fairly consistently, if not always. So we got a good big Brad is just getting like wider every time I see him, and not in like a like me getting wider, but like broader and scarier and jacked. He's just a big beefy lad, and I mean, so Ryan is looking in phenomenal shape as well. So these two guys are looking like superstars right now, and they're still in their infancy, I think, when it comes to in the greater terms of wrestling. So to see them kind of evolve for our very eyes, I'm just gutted that Brad didn't have his brown leather jacket again and all that way back when. I remember the shorts with Evans written on the side, and it's just great to see these guys from beginning to where they are now, and they're just an amazing tag team. The Saints as well. Air Miles, like another guy I've seen quite near, very near the start actually. Really, I think I saw them on one of his debut nights, if anything. So yeah, I've seen him near the start, and Webb I didn't see near the start, but I got to see him quite near with United Pro. So get to see these guys individually over the years, and now they're two of the most cohesive tag teams in the country right now. It's just amazing. The match had so many twists and turns. Everyone got the 2 out of 3 falls concept as well, because sometimes if you're bringing new fans that may have never seen wrestling before, they would have seen the first fall happen. They would be like, oh, the match is over. But no, everyone I think pretty much got it was explained well enough, the 2 out of 3 falls concept, and it was a really good, it's just an excellent match as expected when it came to these two teams. Yeah, what more can I say? So that was when the ring broke. So that was a big moment there. I think the ladder match next was supposed to be the main event, but I don't know. I'm not running the run sheet. Is that right, Sandy? Sandy's asleep, and she's been at our grandparents, or my parents for the last couple of days, so she's recovering. Getting a good sleep in, and I'm just annoying her by speaking. So next was the future title opportunity ladder match, and right, I love like ladder matches. I enjoy ladder matches. I enjoy the one I've enjoyed everyone I've seen in WrestleZone especially, but I loved that I came into this with the person next to me, Kelly, just going, I don't like ladder matches. I hate ladder matches. I hate the concept of ladder matches. And she came out of this one going, that was a really good match. that's testament to everyone involved to this in this match. We came into the preview, I did their preview as well, and I was thinking like, oh, Zach may take easy in this one, and no, he took the worst of some of these bumps and moments, especially that choke slam. Like he got to the top. It was like the whole it's a trope now with just all ladder matches, but it's set up and then one goes across the ring and the end gets laid on the rope, so one gets wedged in the ladder. So clearly it's like a platform. So William Starling choke slammed Zach Dynamite, and Zach had air. It wasn't like he just fell backwards. He got up in the air and landed back first on that ladder, and it was just, my God. You're like in a human viewpoint, I'm like, why? Why did you do that? Again, I saw Zach do get body slammed at Halloween Hijinks last year onto the edge of a bin, like an upright bin that was, well, upside down bin. But he's mad. Zach Dynamite is mad. I don't know what foundations he's building, because they're strong enough that he's still walking after shows. laughing at my own jokes. So Conor Malloy won. But there was so many little bits that could have happened. Tommy Raiden came really close. Dino and Murphy, they were tag team throughout, which is great. You don't see that often. You see the kind of a communication breakdown eventually. I didn't notice that. Whether it happened or not is a different. I may have missed it. William Starling, he unfortunately, I loved the start of it because everyone went and battled and fought outside the ring and everything. And William Starling just stood there and just went, I'll go get a ladder then, and just went and got a ladder, and it was just so funny. I loved it. It was so cool. He did miss his elbow drop. There he got his footing all to cock and ended up slipping. But you know, I still enjoyed Williams' role in it, and he was the one kind of question mark going, why? Well, I know why Sterling's in it, because he's mad enough to do stupid ladder moves. But at the same time, I'm like, why was William in here? And that's why William is like. Any detractors about William Sterling, he knows how to work a crowd, and he knows how to just provide a moment to for people to remember. Might not be the one he wanted, might not be the one he wanted to people to remember, but he provided a moment for people to remember. Connor, our prediction was so wrong in thinking how that was going to go, and but the year is still young. We'll go with that. The year is still young. We may see some things come to fruition with Connor and possibly Ronan. Speaking of Ronan. Oh, Ronan versus Damien. Right. Okay. So I've had good authority. We did notice that Damien seemed to get knocked kind of silly throughout. I thought he had busted ribs or something because he seemed half winded. I have on good authority that he did get injured right near the start of the match. And pretty much everything from that point was on Ronan, which made the match. Actually, in retrospect, at the time, it was really uncomfortable to watch because you could see Damien was struggling, but he was still kind of fighting. He was still, which added to the jeopardy of it all. He was like, I have to battle through. I have to beat this young whippersnapper and teach him a lesson. But yeah, it felt really awkward to watch because you're like, oh, Damien, come on. Come on, stay down please. And but it was in that same mindset, it was amazing that it still felt coherent. Like the match, it was awkward to watch because of it looked like Damien was struggling, but it made Ronan look more of a killer at the same time because he was just picking apart Damien, and Damien was surviving to go through each moment as well when it came to like curb stomps and all that. It's one I wouldn't want to, I think I want to watch back. That's I think it's one I want to watch back and kind of maybe not analyze it, but like kind of just pick it apart, and you know, just kind of just pick the moments where you can see things and how it flows as well. It's one of those really, really interesting ones that I want to see. Let's make sure I've got all my messages. Okay. We do have loads of questions, by the way. Three. That'll get through eventually. They're popping up as I'm doing this. The glass moment, that was terrifying, mainly because it's a family show. But again, it added to that scariness of the whole match built up. So, what was my favorite match from a technical standpoint, or even from an enjoyment standpoint? I would say, but the fact that it happened and it was pretty incident free. Considering that Damien got injured so early, I got to respect both guys in the match. It's one of those things. Going forward, before that, Ronan almost killed himself doing a shooting star press. How Damien moved in time to make sure that Ronan's under rotated, so he almost did like a Brock Lesnar kind of thing. And the fact that Damien was able to just move enough, so he provided like the padding. The landing mat for Ronan's neck was so scary, but they saved it, and that could have been, I mean, it could have been horrible to watch with Damien being injured, but it could have been horrible to watch someone as good as Ronan King, 19 years old, breaking his neck in doing a shooting star press. I would never want to see that at all. So they were able to save that, and it made. Yeah, it was just made for good watch. It was good watching. Like I said, not my favorite technically, but as far as thinking about it and analyzing it in my brain, hopefully this makes sense. It was a fascinating watch, and it was really great. It showed how good Ronan King is, and at 19 years old, again, it disgusts me how good he is. But I'm still want Frame 4. So you know, Battle of Nations. So, yeah, from that, so of course, Damien's daughter was there. She cried, which, you know, to be expected. I would cry if I saw my dad getting stabbed in the eye with a bit of glass. Is it too far in a family show? Maybe. Will people speak about it? Absolutely. I don't know how to think about it, but I'll probably stew my mind for a little bit longer. So there was that match. I can't wait to see Damien return with an eye patch, though. I think that'd be ace. I just eye patch Damien, just murderizing people, and seeing his daughter eventually batter Ronin King. It's going to make for, I don't think it'll be Battle Nations. I think that'll be a cool Halloween hijinks kind of thing, you know. Solid Snake Damien. I'm making a Metal Gear Solid reference I know nothing about, but I want to see Damien, eye patch Damien, battering folk. Like unhinged, like a bulldog, just like scratching, like Rocket, as well. For people who've seen Guardians, you should have by now. It's been like 2 weeks, so yeah, like a little Rocket raccoon, just scratching and clawing at people. Like, how dare you let this happen, kind of thing. And the unhinged moments that could come from it. Oh, I'm in for it. From that point, so again, I always mention Kelly in these things, but she comes to these shows and I appreciate it and she loves them, so it I like getting her opinion on these things. She was sitting there going, that was too far, that's just too far on the show. Look at Damien's daughter crying, this is too far. And then Brian Tucker came out to his Bay City Rollers theme music for Bye Bye Scotty. So she was like, that's too far, no, they shouldn't have done that, that was too far. Bye bye, Scotty. Bye bye. It was the juxtaposition of that, which sums up wrestling beautifully. It was the juxtaposition of going, that was disgusting, that was too far, to, yes, the comedy match is happening. Yeah, next. Woohoo! It was so good. I'm glad Damien is generally is fine, as far as I'm aware. But that juxtaposition was hilarious to be a part of and to see. This was a bit mad, the tag team match. Omar Muhammad and Mr. WrestleZone against Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker. And yeah, it was so weird, because Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker have been a team for a while, yet they are the most bumbling buffoons in the world when it comes to actually being a tag team. It's like they've spent all that time devising shenanigans and plans to try and catch Mr. WrestleZone out, or to annoy people with their walliness, but they haven't actually taken any time to learn how to be a tag team. This is Brian Tucker, that's been a multiple time tag team champion. So it was just hilarious that they've just no cohesiveness, but at the same time they have cohesiveness because they're able to do this bumbling buffoonery so well. I can't begin to describe how that seem doesn't work, but does work. Mr. WrestleZone, I said in my recap that Omar Muhammad is just like walking into a room where everything is going wrong, and he's just standing there going, kind of thing. And there was Mr. WrestleZone, every time he tried to exit the ring, he tried to go over the top rope and fallen over. He had a wee bag, shopping bag with him, a bag for life. He came out with that, and inside it was an extra long tag rope that he tied up and got into the ring to try and tag Omar there side the ring, and then got tangled in the tag rope on his way out of the ring. Martin Clunas was absolutely pissing himself laughing, trying to help unknot Mr. WrestleZone from the tag rope. And it was just, again, we're looking at technical standpoint. Like, if Jim Cornette watched this match, he would have blown a gasket, because it was so stupid, but it was so entertaining at the same time. And, you know, 5 stars. it was like one of those where I think it was meant to be so bad, but it was but so good. And it was one of those matches where you go, I can't explain this match to people, but I like it. You know, it was just one of those, madness, absolute madness. So after all that, Kaylee didn't win the raffle again, I don't think. So, you know, if K&K Wrestle Factory ever return, she'll be raging about it. After all that, we got the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship match. Lost Boy Aspen, no longer Aspen Faith, Lost Boy Aspen defeating Caleb Valhalla by pinfall to retain the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. Not smug at all. Not smug at all. I was scared though. there was a lot of moments where I thought, "Oh God, oh no, he's." As I said before, I'm happy. I would have been happy if Caleb won, but I didn't want him to win at the same time. So I was so happy when. But the match itself was just, it was just two behemoths battering the fuck out of each other. There's my one F-bomb in this episode. Absolutely battering lumps out of each other. And it was tense because you couldn't call who was going to win. So you're sitting there going, every moment, every big move, Caleb hit a spear. I don't think he was able to hit the Hell Ride, but he was close to hitting the Hell Ride. Aspen was had this amazing, there was this amazing transition. I can't remember how he got to it. I think it was Caleb lifted him up for like a power slam. And Aspen leaned back, so it was popped up for a tombstone pile driver and then hooked the legs like the old what's it called? What was King's Catch finisher called? Oh, it's gonna annoy me so much. I can't remember off the top of my head. But it was underhook, like kind of tombstone, and that should have been it. And they kicked out, Caleb kicked out, and it was like, oh, kind of thing. And It was just a phenomenal main event, and it felt like a main event. It was different to everything else on the show, and it was great. And there's obviously a ton of bias at my side here because of two of my favorite wrestlers, but that was just a phenomenal, epic main event match. And it's one of those ones where I don't want to see it every month kind of thing, but I'd love to see some little weaving connection to get to that point again, to see Caleb versus Aspen, because it's going to be one of those special matches that you see in WrestleZone elsewhere. I think it's going to be one of those special matches you see that always delivers, or at least it's always going to be hard hitting at the very least. And it was just a great match. Like I said, I could be absolutely biased. Someone who's going for the first time probably watched it and may have thought it was rubbish, but for me, it was phenomenal. It's up there as my favorite match. It probably was my favorite match of the night. As a quote-unquote journalist, ladder match just squeaked it for me because it was a really good ladder match. But just every match on this show delivered something, and that's what you want. You don't want a forgettable match. There was no forgettable matches on this show. They were all delivered, all gave us a surprise, gave us a edge of your seat moment, which is what you want from a wrestling show in general. And I loved it. I loved the show. And people are going to be fed up for me. It's the Aberdeen Wankathon, as always. But I go to these shows, I enjoy them. I like to tell people that I enjoy them. Sue me. Right, let's go some questions before we wrap up, and I absolutely go absolutely not doing work at the moment, and then I can get this processed, put it on Patreon, and people can listen to it early. So Callum asking, who's next to walk the granite road? At the moment it looks like Connor, because he won the title opportunity, but there's so many. I think now that Reckless have kind of went on their hiatus, I would love to see some guys down there have a shot at Aspen. Like, there's so many guys in WrestleZone that have had an opportunity at the title recently, or have had matches with Aspen, and you can absolutely do any of them. Like, you can do Aspen Dino again, you can do Aspen Murphy, Aspen Connor, Aspen Ronan would be a beautiful match. Any of the Foundation guys, the singles matches with the Fair City Saints, you could literally have anything you want. Allen, Captain Allen. He won Aberdeen Anarchy. Give Captain Allen a shot. But I would love to see some newer faces as well come through and try and walk the granite road, as you've put it. Guys like your Deacon Matthews, like see Dickie Divers back up here. Why not? So there's just so many ways that you could have. obviously Omar had a shot, I think, at one of the galas or Comic Con. Obviously Omar against Aspen. Give Mr. WrestleZone against Aspen. I don't know how. I don't know where. Just for a moment. Give me Mr. WrestleZone versus Aspen. I don't know. It's an unpredictable time in wrestling. Oh, I got really close to the microphone there. It's an unpredictable time, and I'm really bad at predicting. So whatever happens, I'm going to enjoy it. I'm going to enjoy it for sure. I think that's Amazon Man here. So I'm going to pause the recording for a sec. It was the man from Amazon, so who's interrupting my episodes quite frequently now. So I'm going to use my Brian Tucker technical difficulties, which I love it. So any excuse for me to use that Brian Tucker clip. So yeah, more questions. So talked about the Granite Road. So let's go to Instagram. Find it. Okay. Mr. Referee Dennis Law, he asked, was it a quiet journey home after the result of the main event? Did you wind up Kelly? I am a respectful person. And plus we were listening to Eurovision on the way home. So most of it was just listening to Eurovision and chatting. I had my little smug moment just before we left. I had my little smug moment in the car as well. I think it might be in that little bit I recorded and put out before the montage. After the montage. I was a little bit smug. And Mr. Caleb Valhalla, how has the split household coped since the show? It's we're doing okay. We don't need to enter therapy. We're fine. it's one of those things where I was, like I said, I was coming in going, I don't know who I want to win. Oh, I know who I want to win, but I'm not sure who will win. And then coming out of the show, pretty much Kelly was of the opinion going, yeah, my favorite didn't win. But it was a really good match, though. so you kind of get downhearted too much about it when Caleb yourself had put everything into the match. And we haven't talked about Caleb's cape. Caleb had a cape, and I think Edna Mode may have cursed Caleb Valhalla for having a cape. It was a beautiful cape. It was amazing. It reminded me, as I put a picture up on Twitter of Kane when he had that cape one time. That's kind of what it reminded me of. It was a totally different style, but just kind of vision of this humongous guy with a cape. It was beautiful. Actually, a lot of people's gear was amazing. So yeah, the household's fine. We're all safe. The boy had returned. He was told the news. He pooped. You know, so I don't know if that was a dirty protest or he was shocked at the result. I don't know. We'll find out in the future if WrestleZone comes to Keith, and he can find out for himself what it's all about. So yeah. We're speaking about gear. Caleb had an amazing gear. Aspen had amazing gear. Aspen, right. So this is where we think where I had moments where I thought, oh, Caleb might win. But there was a moment Aspen speaking about in our episode that we've done with him, that he talked about that his gear kind of evolves, and then once it reaches a point, he strips back, goes to the start again. But I noticed his gear's kind of got still got like room to add big flair to it and that. So I like that evolution of attire. So it was like, yeah. So it had the pink, but it had like a bit in the middle that was there was like vinyl kind of material that you could possibly add some bits in there. So that's just me being a big old geeking fanboy. Tom Raiden had cool gear. Ronin with his Jeff Jarrett-esque, I don't know what to call it, vest gear, whips and chains. I've no idea what the technical term for it is, but it looked so fitting with Ronin King. We'll go with that. I don't think I can pull it off. I look like Bastion Booger, but it fit with Ronin King. Tom Raiden had cool gear. I think everyone else, everyone kind of had maybe just freshened up versions of their original gear. I'm still amazed by Oliver Green having a tattoo on his armpit. That just blows my mind, and I can't think of anything worse in the world that I'd want done. I mean, there's some places I think worse, but you know, for in the grand scheme of things, armpit tattoos there. So yeah, like I said, I've answered all the questions. Right, I've talked about the show. I loved it. Thumbs up. I've talked on for way too long. I've got to use the Brian Tucker technical difficulties video, so I'm all happy. I'm gonna go and just relax until whenever Battle of Nations is, like August sometime probably. Thank you for watching. Thank you for team support. Thank you for speaking to me at the show. I am a very awkward person socially, but I am, as I said, I am trying to get better at it. I will try to hold conversations. If not, I will try my best to at least look like I am, at least get my face to look like I'm interested in what you're saying. Even if my brain is, my face sometimes betrays me. But other than that, continue to support SWN. That would be amazing. I think we're taking a break maybe for a week on the SWN podcast because we're getting prepared for the Day of Birth Bonanza. But check social media at Scott Resnett and you can find out more. Have a good one. Go watch some bloody wrestling, right? You hear? Go do it.